One of them is actually collecting, bringing it back. We've done some work on off-grid solar products, and it's so difficult to bring back these products, which are distributed across very difficult to access regions anyway. They bring a lot of value, of course, to those communities, to those users, but at the end of life, it's a huge challenge to actually bring it back because there's no incentive mechanism, there are no frameworks to actually pay for those costs of actually collecting and bringing them back. So that's the first challenge. The second is actually recycling them, because those technologies don't still exist. How do you recycle a solar panel which is, you know, fused? It's got layers of, you know, amazing things sandwiched between glass. There's no way to recover those things. Another challenge is actually safety hazards, and lithium batteries are really a very good example. You know, they are very good in some ways, much better than lead acid batteries, but nobody wants to recycle lithium ferrophosphate batteries, for example. There are fire hazards. If you put them in a shredder, you know, there's a very high likelihood it might just burst up in flames. First of all is, of course, you know, taking the reduce, reuse, recycle kind of approach and really reducing the number of things, number of products that you need. One of the ways to do that is actually going into a kind of sharing economy mode. And we see that happening quite a lot already. You know, with cars, you see that happening. People are owning fewer cars because they're using mobility services. So you're moving from a product ownership model or a product ownership mindset to a service ownership mindset. So you just use the product for the service. So you actually don't need the product. Philips has actually been pioneering in this, where they've said, actually, we don't need to sell bulbs. People want light. So by selling light, it's better for us because we have regular continued business opportunities, you know, cash flow, instead of just selling a bulb at one point. And because they still own that product, they have the incentive to make that product better, so last longer. But even earlier in the value chain, even earlier in the use, even in design, you can, you know, build these kind of things so you have more modular systems where you don't need to replace a whole thing. You just upgrade small parts. We've seen this with phones, and Fairphone is a good example, where you have a phone that can be just upgraded if you want a battery, if you want the camera, if you want, you know, the speaker, etc. So yeah, so there are various ways to do this, and it's happening. I think I'm quite positive and optimistic on that front. I think a lot of countries are looking at that, where, you know, they are trying to already build those kind of legislation frameworks which have been, you know, applied elsewhere, you know, in e-waste, which I know a lot about. It's about how do you set, you know, frameworks to make sure that there is the financing available for collection, for recycling, for, you know, the treatment costs. And already, you know, even developing countries are going in that direction, where they're saying, okay, right from the beginning, let's put these frameworks in place, not only for electronics, it could be for many other things as well. Where you have the opportunity to make sure that you have the system to collect, to recycle, to have that circular economy chain built in, supported with legislation. And you don't have to, you know, first wait for the problem to really become worse before you start solving it.